On the balcony outside Rajiv's first floor study room, he had placed a birdbath at the peak of last year's summer. Not really a birdbath, more like a small earthen water bowl. But despite its size, it began to generate a lot of attention quite soon. These frequent flyers were obviously attracted to the water, but also by the surrounding foliage and the terrace garden upstairs. However, when the monsoon arrived, and the roads turned into rivers, and streets into streams, there was little use for the birdbath. Until the sun finally broke through the clouds, and the sky was bright and cerulean again. When post-monsoon blooms began to flower, and the greenery was washed clean, life around the birdbath restarted.
Morning invariably breaks with a group of gregarious jungle babblers, their cacophony interrupted only when intrigue gets the better of them as they peer into the room. One of the first visitors to the birdbath was the brown-headed barbet. Taking his usual flight path from the perch to the railing, he emits his happy guttural call, which is what always alerts Rajiv to his presence. He'll usually spend some time checking out his surroundings, before hopping down to the water. When another barbet calls from nearby, it's probably his mate. Otherwise, they tend to be very territorial, and defensive of their arboreal turf. When he's not at the water, he's attacking the mandarin oranges in the garden. Loves a bright, clear, sunny day. There's a family of miners nearby that will drop in often during the day. With a varied vocalization repertoire, they whistle and screech, and sometimes make strangely human-sounding noises. But a less frequent visitor is the common miner's cousin. The Brahmani starling or Brahmani miner is named after his hairstyle with the choti. Their scientific name, Pagodarum, is based on their habit of perching on temple pagodas in southern India. The red-vented bulbul is fairly common, having adapted to urban life. But this one is actually a resident, having sired a clutch of hatchlings in a flower pot nest on the ground floor. The red-whiskered bulbul or crested bulbul is less common, but still a frequent visitor. Even so, they're more often heard than seen. The Indian house crow will drop in either for a drink, or with a piece of food that he needs to dunk into the water to soften and make more palatable. But that generally messes up the birdbath with residue that the others don't appreciate. Like this little brown dove, or laughing dove, doesn't look particularly amused. even though she will take a few sips. She'd much rather have a clean tub of water. The reticent and shy Eurasian collared dove, a distant cousin of the little brown dove, though not a frequent visitor, will fly by every once in a while. This oriental magpie robin is an actual neighbor, nesting in a hole in the tree across the road. Sometimes a young juvenile will accompany its dad, but usually it's the adult male that comes, either to drink or to forage. This hyperactive little guy is barely 8 or 9 centimeters long. Known as the Indian white eye, earlier called the Oriental white eye, he is a nearby neighbor who spends much of the day in the surrounding foliage. There's a pair of them that'll visit frequently together during the breeding season. Of the millions in the city, only a couple of rock pigeons have found their way here. Although usually unobtrusive, sometimes they'll occupy the bird bath for extended periods of time. The rufous tree pie, 20 inches long, is 3 times the diameter of the bath. Their harsh call is frequently heard from the treetops, but they will drop down for a drink every now and then. Just as difficult to spot is the once ubiquitous house sparrow. They seem to prefer the terrace garden, but will come for a drink occasionally. Like the sparrow, the female purple sunbird also prefers the garden to the bath. The common tailor bird is constantly on the move, active and restless. Although generally hidden in the trees, their loud calls often give them away. This black-rumped flameback, or lesser golden-backed woodpecker, is about a foot long and very nervous. Apparently, they're one of the very few woodpeckers seen in urban areas. The second time Rajiv saw him, it took 2 minutes of nervous fretting, before he finally took his leap of faith. The trilling, whinying sound from the trees suggests his mate may be close by.
Birds need water throughout the year, even in the cold, dry winter months. In fact, especially in the winter, when natural sources of water are scarce. They need water not only for drinking, but also for bathing, the all-important function of feather maintenance. Dampening the plumes loosens the dirt and makes their feathers easier to preen. Clean feathers make it easier for them to fly, and hence survive.
Both, the red-vented bulbul as well as the red-whiskered bulbul, come a number of times during the day, probably the most frequent bathers. Definitely the ones that seem to have the most fun. They'll whistle and sing, splash around and shake their feathers, and then do it all over again. And again. Although a lone babbler will come sometimes, they do seem to prefer communal baths. Slightly larger than a babbler, the brown-headed barbet seems to have some difficulty getting into the birdbath. He's trying to get his posterior into the water, so he can flap and splash by fanning his tail and wings. But the bowl is just that little bit too small, and the water is low. Perhaps he'll try again later, when the water level is higher. Better, but not perfect. One more try then. This bathing ritual is absolutely critical because the thorough preening and fluffing which follows depends on a good soak. Despite being larger than the barbets, the rock pigeons have no difficulty fitting into the water bowl. They could spend upwards of 10 minutes in the tub, if left undisturbed. They'll flump in the water, and splash occasionally, and will often display a sunning posture, which entails rolling one third onto its side and fanning the upper wing.
Preening is a maintenance behavior found in birds, and usually follows a good splash up. It involves the use of the beak to position feathers and clean plumage. Feathers contribute to a bird's insulation, waterproofing, and aerodynamic flight, and so are vital to its survival.
Amongst the frequent flyers that come to Rajiv's balcony birdbath, preening is seen as an individual function, with the exception of the jungle babblers, who often make it a social event. It's called allopreening. The main purpose of this mutual grooming is to reduce instinctive aggression when birds are in close contact. Allopreening is also believed to help strengthen bonding. Doesn't always work though. Apart from generally keeping feathers clean, the preening process also involves gathering preen oil from a gland at the base of their tails and spreading it through their feathers with their beaks. That ensures waterproofing of their plumes. Even the house crow takes time off for a bit of bill cleaning. This, it seems, is also a way of honing the keratin layer of the beak, much like us clipping our nails. After a drink at the birdbath, the rufous tree pie will sometimes chill on the overhanging branches, doing his thing in the shade.
After the morning's foraging, drinking, bathing and grooming, some of the birds will perch on the branches directly in front of the birdbath, and rest. Sometimes they'll call out to their mates, or just relax in the shade. An interesting aspect at the birdbath is the social behavior between species. While one would expect the larger birds to display dominant behavior, it's surprising how sociable and civil some of the interactions are. The courtesy of waiting, while others finish their activity, is very often on display.
Here, the barbet waits patiently for the babblers to finish their bath, before hopping down to the water. If he's not always patient, a wing spread from the current occupant will suggest a bit of annoyance. Or, if someone from another species tries to hustle, a gentle shoo away will get the appropriate message across. Occasionally, of course, there could be a brief standoff. But, if there is a birdbath protocol, it is generally followed. The rock pigeon is 4 times longer than the Indian white eye, weighs 30 times more, and has a wingspan that is 8 times wider. But she waits. As does the tailor bird for the sparrow, or the pigeon for the tailor bird. But of course, there's always a bully in the pack. As winter draws to an end, the leaves on surrounding trees turn to yellow, and then to brown as they begin to fall. In 2 weeks, the trees are bare, but immediately, fresh leaves begin to sprout, hiding the blue sky with a canopy of fresh green. It is at this time that you begin to see these duets start to play. From early spring, couples start to arrive at the birdbath. Babblers that normally roam in groups, now come in pairs. And the solitary fliers of post-monsoon and winter months, now come along with their mates. Like the Brahmani starling. The now familiar brown-headed barbet brings his mate along, for the first time, usually in the evenings. The red-whiskered bulbuls, whose chatter and songs can be heard almost throughout the day, now begin to come in pairs for their frequent splashing in the water. The common minor birds, whose rakish squawks and croaks often rent the quiet afternoons, will now come as a twosome to drink, or to rest in silence. Even the house crow comes with his mate for a drink of clear, cool water. Having left their flock, the Indian white eyes pair up for the breeding season from late spring. They spend a lot of the day foraging around the birdbath. Pigeons are known to mate for life, and will often spend time with each other, in the water bowl. Huddled together, they fluff their feathers, either to trap body heat or as part of a thorough cleaning. The once nervous black-rumped flameback is now a lot more confident. And it's the first time he's brought his mate. He's ready to show off a bit, so he won't brook any interference. Unlike his crimson crown and crest, the female has a black fore crown with white spots. Only the rear crest is red. He's clearly loving it. Who doesn't like a nice long bath? The water's clean. The tub is right. His wing feathers, plume and down, his thick and stiff tail, all are now sodden and heavy. He's likely to get into a bit of trouble when he wants to fly out of the bath. Oops! Not a firm grip on the iron railing. But no harm done, other than a bruised ego perhaps. You know you're at the business end of the breeding season when you notice nest building activity in the early summer months. The crow's nest may look like an ungainly mess of twigs and sticks, but on the inside, there is a lining of soft plant fibers. This male tailor bird is gathering, and cleaning, delicate plant tendrils which he will take to the female. She would have found a leaf or two that she has rolled into a cocoon shape, and will use these threads brought by the male, to stitch the leaves together and line both the inside and outside, thus creating the nest. Meanwhile, downstairs on the ground floor, a family has already started. The red-vented bulbuls have hatched their young and are now in the process of raising their hatchlings. For the next 2 weeks, the fledglings will be fed constantly. Both parents hunt for food, and both do the feeding. While one often stays on guard, the other busies itself at the nest. The nestlings soon open their eyes, and pin feathers begin to sprout. The entire day is rife with the sounds of chirping parents and cheeping babies. Till one day, the nestlings are out of their nest, ready for their first flying lesson. Just in time, as the monsoon winds begin to blow, and the first drops of rain herald a new season.
Thank you. At night I hear the rhythm of the ocean as it breaks on the shore. And I think about all the things that I am grateful for. They say